Getting Started in Finding a Financial Advisor. Written by Chuck Jaffe. Narrated by Allan Robertson. Introduction. The safest way to double your money is to fold it over once and put it in your pocket. Ken Hubbard. There has never been a time when people needed more help with their finances, nor a time when they were more scared about hiring an advisor. As the stock market was reaching the depths of its biggest downturn in our lifetimes, Bernie Madoff's $50 billion deception of rich, brilliant investors was coming to light. And while the world's largest investment fraud scheme captured the big headlines and the big investors, there were dozens of smaller schemes perpetrated on average folks by rogue brokers and financial planners. Chances are good that you never heard about Earl Blondo, the Raleigh, North Carolina investment advisor, who used his job to gain access to funds being held in trust for the benefit of a client, or of Dallas advisor Cliff Robertson, who not only duped investors of their life savings and tapped their bank accounts, but stole his clients' identities too. While the Madoff case caught the headlines, the smaller cases, and I picked those two at random from a file filled with hundreds of advisor arrests and guilty pleas from the last 2 years, were far more common and devastating. Beyond the victims who were directly affected by these frauds, the damage included the public perception that hiring an advisor could, indeed, be asking for trouble more than finding a solution. While that kind of knee-jerk overreaction is not rational, it's hard to overcome, especially during financial times when the market makes many of the best advisors look like they are unable to help. Moreover, fear actually makes many consumers more susceptible to the bad guys. Not knowing whom to trust, they wind up at a cocktail party or on the sidelines of the soccer field chatting with someone who happens to be an advisor and thinking, "Providence has brought me someone I can trust at just the right time in my life." Invariably, every bad guy was similarly trusted by people who let those personal connections override the standard due diligence necessary to separate the quality advisors from the boobs, idiots, frauds, and charlatans. This audiobook will walk you through that process, and no advisor deserves to be working for you if he or she can't pass muster. It's a self-help audiobook for finding people who can help you. It's important to recognize two key facts when it comes to hiring financial advisors. One, the vast majority of them are honest, scrupulous, trustworthy, hard-working folks with good intentions. Two, you can do almost all of these jobs yourself. It's equally important to recognize the corollaries to those facts. One, it doesn't help you that there are so many good advisors if you pick an incompetent, lazy, or crooked one. Two, you can butcher your finances as well or better than anyone else if you don't know what you're doing. Think of financial advisors the same way you think of carpenters, plumbers, electricians, and auto mechanics. In each of those cases, you can do the job yourself. There are books and how-to articles, dedicated specialty magazines, and television shows dedicated to showing you the way. But you're better off hiring a pro if you lack the time, ability, know-how, and willingness to finish the task properly and without incident. Having picked up this audiobook, you are on the verge of making one of the biggest financial decisions of your life, one that will have more impact on your financial well-being than simply picking a good stock or mutual fund. That's precisely why it's important to go through this process the right way. You don't need to listen to every minute to find great advisors. Decide what you need from this audiobook and use it to your advantage. Whether you get the soup-to-nuts education on selecting advisors of every stripe, Or use it as a guide for grilling the candidates, questioning their references, and doing background checks. Either way, it should help quell your fears on both sides of the current frightmare affecting consumers. It will help you decide if you need an advisor to get through these tough times, and will then enable you to hire one who won't be in tomorrow's headlines. Part 1. A Soup to Nuts Guide to Selecting Your Advisor. Chapter 1. You need financial help. Now what? The only way not to think about money is to have a great deal of it. Edith Wharton. Most people know when they need help to solve one of life's problems. Oh, they might pull out a plunger when the toilet backs up, or pop the hood and look at the engine when the car breaks down, or take a store-bought remedy or cook up chicken soup to try to heal themselves. But if they lack the skill to make a quick fix, they're going to find someone to lend a hand. And that makes sense with your plumbing or your car, because a bad repair job could damage or ruin one of your biggest assets. Likewise, your good health is irreplaceable. Yet, when it comes to finances, which hopefully will be the biggest asset of your lifetime, people are skittish, scared, and reluctant to seek out help. Talking about money is still one of the biggest taboos in modern society, so people learn their lessons from parents, friends, and co-workers, at the barbershop or on the sidelines of the kids' soccer games. They'll watch television shows or listen to radio hosts, read articles, and try to cook up a portfolio or an investment strategy with help from all of those sources. A 2009 study by Sun Life Financial showed that one-third of Americans cited online or television news as a place where they turn for financial advice. That's nearly the same percentage of people who cited financial advisors. But finances and money are not like food, where failure to follow a recipe or simply using bad ingredients can leave a bad taste in your mouth. You can throw out a bad dish and forget about it by the time your next meal arrives. But bad financial mistakes will be with you for years, possibly as long as the rest of your life. In the end, there comes a point, typically when someone has amassed enough money that he can see the cost of mismanaging it, when most people acknowledge that they could use some help, the kind of insight that will make them comfortable that their biggest decisions will turn out right. That's when one of two things happens. They jump on board with the first possible helper they find, or they put off looking for help, believing that it's easier to find a mythical creature like a unicorn than it is to find someone who is smart, savvy, and worth the cost of their advisory fees. Either they believe that the easiest way to amass a small fortune is to start with a big one and let a financial planner, insurance agent, banker, or broker lose it down, or they don't believe anyone could turn their meager holdings into that small fortune. Both sides are wrong, because the expectations are wrong. Go back to the basic need for help, the necessary fix to the plumbing or car. You want things fixed and running right, safe, and protected, so that you can live your everyday life without worrying about a messy problem or a personal catastrophe. You don't expect an auto mechanic to change your car from an American-made sedan into a Porsche or a Lamborghini. You simply expect them to help you keep the car running properly so that you can reach your destination and make the journey to wherever you want to go. That's precisely why you should hire financial advisors, to help you make the journey from where you are to where you want to go. At the very least, over the course of a lifetime, you will need to manage investments, amass college and retirement savings, secure and work out loans, buy or sell property, insure that home and your other possessions, protect your family and home against catastrophic losses, develop a plan to pass your life's work to your heirs, and pay taxes on the whole thing. Say hello to a broker or financial planner, banker, real estate agent, insurance agent, lawyer and or estate planner, and a tax preparer or accountant. Finding someone trustworthy who can do any or all of these jobs is not as hard as searching for a unicorn, but it's also not as easy as handing your money to the next person you meet who purports to know something. That's why you want to go about hiring financial advisors the right way, no matter which job they'll do for you. I'm always amazed that people spend more time researching a new flat-screen television or home computer than they spend checking into the background of the person who will determine a big chunk of their financial future. Presumably, no one fears offending the television by asking tough questions about it, whereas they are uncomfortable asking personal, prying questions to people they don't know. By reading this book, you are distinguishing yourself from that crowd and showing that you want to do the research and ask these types of questions. Good for you. You're about to learn that hiring good advisors is not an impossible task. You'll be able to do a lot of research from home, on your computer, and the rest you can do by simply taking your time to get questions answered. With that in mind, you should remember throughout the process of looking for advisors that you, and hopefully your spouse or life partner, are the only person you trust implicitly to have your best interests at heart. Everyone else must earn your trust, starting from scratch. No one gets a pass, no matter how much you love or trust the person who gave you a recommendation. If they can't live up to the rigorous selection process described here, you either can't trust them or they don't deserve to work with your hard-earned money. Start your search for any type of financial advisor by asking yourself a few simple questions. What kind of assistance do I need? Need is a critical factor in most of your other purchases, and it plays a direct role in your choice of advisors. If you just don't want to deal with the hassle of filing your tax return, but you are a basic two-income family with a plain vanilla earnings picture, you have a lot of choices. But if you are an entrepreneur with head of household status, supporting children and parents, and wanting to make sure you take advantage of all available tax credits, you'll need someone who has worked on cases like yours before. The more advanced your needs, the more you will tilt your decision-making process to getting additional services and paying the full ticket price. That's why you start the process with a needs assessment, a self-examination of what you are trying to accomplish, what type of advisor is best suited to help, and what you want in an advisory relationship from that service provider. This is particularly important in financial services, in which so many products are sold rather than purchased based on the consumer's knowledge. No one wakes up one morning and says, "Today I need to go to the grocery store, fill the tank with gas, and buy a variable life insurance policy." She might be thinking it's time to increase her coverage safety net and perhaps save some more, but it's the insurance advisor who pushes the policies. And because variable life policies are not right for everyone, it's only years later when the person wakes up and starts second-guessing her decisions. The process is not that dissimilar from when a consumer buys some new technological gadget or doodad and is pushed into all sorts of features that he doesn't really know about or need. You don't want to pay up to get features and abilities you don't need. That's a waste of money that ultimately will play into how satisfied you are with the advisor. Knowing your needs and being able to explain them to an advisor will go a long way toward ensuring that you hire people who can remain good advisors for the rest of your lifetime. The ideal advisor-client relationship. There are some advisors you date and others you marry. If what you need is a quick fix, you want to write a simple will, you are looking for a one-time portfolio review, you are selling your house and moving away, or you need to answer an unexpected notice from the Internal Revenue Service, You may want to engage an advisor on a one-time gig, getting the job done without much regard for the future. But if you need help and can see yourself requiring assistance and hand-holding again in the future, then you should look for an advisor you can have the ideal relationship with. The ideal relationship between client and advisor ends under one of two circumstances: you die, or he or she retires. Being a serial employer of advisors, where you move from one to the next, is asking for trouble. It gives you more chances to encounter a rogue, and each new counselor may try to prove his or her worth by changing up what you did before, and a constantly changing strategy is the same as having no strategy for reaching your goals. So, while you might be looking for help because of something that is happening right now in your life, try to view potential advisors as someone you'd like to call on whenever you need help for the rest of your life. What's it going to cost me? Price is always a key consideration. No one, no matter how wealthy, has the ability to say cost is no object when it comes to his or her financial affairs. That is how large fortunes unravel in lurid tales of greed, fraud, or ineptitude. Just as you eyeball grocery prices before making a selection, or get an estimate before hiring a contractor to do some home repairs, you need to ask financial counselors how they bill for their services. You may worry that they will burst into an, "If you have to ask me, you can't afford me," rage. But that hot-headed reaction would actually be a good thing, because it would let you know you're talking to the wrong advisor. Smart financial advisors of all stripes are happy to explain their charges and justify the reasons behind their rates. It is up to you to decide if you want to pay the freight. A price check is also important because fees and payment structures can vary tremendously from one advisor to the next. I have seen two financial planners in the same town, both providing similar sample plans and advice, charge rates that varied by hundreds of dollars per hour. The higher charges could go to pay for the fancier office, the years of experience, and the professional designations earned, or it might just be that one provider believes he can get away with charging more. We'd all love to get free advice. But you may be hiring a planner or broker because the free counsel you have gotten from friends and loved ones has been worth every penny you have paid for it, and now you want a better grade of assistance. That said, seek out a price point and pricing structure that you feel good about, because that will encourage you to use the advisor's services regularly and build the relationship. What do I get for my money? If you haven't worked with an advisor before, you don't truly know what to expect. Sure, you've seen financial planners and brokers on television shows, but you're doing your own reality program here. Even if you think you know what to expect from an advisor, learn about everything available. One key place where consumers make a mistake is that they focus entirely on the bottom line without recognizing that what matters with an advisor is the journey to reach that end point. Consumers focus in on how much money have you made other clients by picking mutual funds, rather than on how do you determine what mutual funds are right for me. What most people want from a financial advisor, particularly financial planners and people who manage money, is emotional discipline, the ability to put together a sensible plan and then stick with that program through thick and thin. The advisor doesn't just determine the strategy or pick the investments. She provides the hand-holding necessary to see the plan through tough economic and market times. Just as you would want a refrigerator salesman to explain the different ways the removable shelves can improve your life and allow you to decide whether it is worth paying for a second crisper, so can you talk to a prospective financial advisor about what the relationship is going to be like and what you can expect. Will it be regular phone calls and the ability to chat without receiving a bill every time you need a consultation because you anticipate a major event in your life? Will the broker accept your calls whenever the market makes you nervous? Does the accountant or financial advisor offer a regular newsletter to customers? And is that publication merely a pass-along from a national office, or does it reflect the advisor's feelings about the market, economy, law changes, investment strategies, and more? How much of your contact with the advisor will be person-to-person, and how much will be you getting blast mail tweets because your counselor uses Twitter to soothe clients? Your needs and desires must be a match for what the advisor is offering, or you will never be satisfied. Can one size fit all? Bankers can sell you investments. Many insurance agents do financial and estate planning. Accountants and tax preparers offer investment advice. Stockbrokers now offer planning services, and financial planners offer just about everything. These hazy definitions and boundaries make it so that advisors frequently cross the line from one specialty to the next, hoping to sell you another product or to capture more of your assets under their management. It's tempting to let an advisor cross the line into a different arena because you already enjoy working with him. He understands your situation and has earned your trust. One-stop shopping is a convenience many people desire. But a good accountant isn't necessarily an outstanding financial planner, or vice versa. Advanced credentials are no guarantee. The fact that a counselor studied for a certificate in another specialty does not make him good at that job, especially if it is no more than a sideline business. While it may be common practice for an advisor to wear two hats, it is malpractice if he can't do each job equally well. Over your lifetime, you are building a team of financial advisors, and you don't want a team of utility infielders, players who are qualified to fill many vacant positions, but not good enough to star at any one job. Each job an advisor is going to do for you requires starting your search from scratch, asking new questions, and determining whether you can be as happy with her counsel in the second area as you are in the job you first hired her for. You don't want to be her guinea pig. Without the same expert credentials as a full-time practitioner, you should stick to one advisor for each need. And while consumers value convenience, think of the potential inconvenience too. If the advisor fails in his second job on your team, you actually lose counsel in two areas, as your primary relationship is likely to be impaired when you fire him from his secondary role. Financial services is not a one-size-fits-all business. If an advisor's play is to get a bigger role feels forced or the least bit uncomfortable, don't let it happen. Can I afford it? You've already looked at the cost, but affordability is a different issue. Some of the priciest financial planners in the world charge thousands of dollars for the same services that their clients could get for 90% less. There is financial assistance at virtually every price point, from ultra discount to through-the-nose chic. On the low end, it might be free advice offered by a public agency, such as the Internal Revenue Service, or a consultation with your own mutual fund company, or using their discounted advisory services. The upper end of the scale includes top planners who charge hundreds of dollars just for an initial interview, regardless of whether you hire them to work for you, and money managers who take a big slice of the assets they run for you each year. A lot of people who could not actually afford to work with upper-crust private money managers snuck and chiseled their way into becoming clients of convicted fraud Bernie Madoff. They were stretching their finances for something they could not afford and lowering their defenses at the same time because they could never get a personal consultation or meeting with Madoff, all because they assumed that a rich, wealthy advisor with a long record just had to be terrific and safe and worth the risk of putting all of their eggs in one basket. they might have been right had they not selected a crook. The Madoff case is proof that it is not enough to simply look at what you are being charged. You must see how it fits into your budget. If you want ongoing financial planning services but cannot afford a $300 an hour planner, then you will have two shopping choices. Change your expectations about how often you actually work with this advisor, or set your sights on a lower-priced advisor who can meet your quality expectations and still deliver the service you need. The right time to hire an advisor. If you knew trouble was coming, you'd get out of the way or fix the problems long before they get out of hand. With your finances, it is best to assume that there is trouble ahead and to go for assistance that will help you avoid it. If you wait until you have trouble before hiring an advisor, the process becomes much harder to do properly. You'll go with a gut feeling or forego background checks or simply lower your standards to get out of the pinch. But there's a big difference between waiting too long and having real trouble. If the IRS is beating down your door demanding money, you need help right now. If you just inherited $1 million and want to put it to work securing your future, you can set it aside in an interest-bearing account and take your time finding the right advisor. No one ever got to retirement age and said, "Shoot, I can't quit now because I missed a day or week or month in the market." Plenty of people have rushed into bad financial advisory relationships and arrived at retirement age years later to wonder where their money had gone. It's best to hire advisors when you don't need them. If you can't do that, at least understand that most financial concerns are not so pressing that you should settle for an advisor without putting him or her through a full and thorough review. Can I do it myself? Financial planners like to compare what they do to doctors, as if managing money is somehow akin to brain surgery. It's not. For years, advisors have hated me for comparing them to plumbers and auto mechanics, but that's a much better comparison than a doctor. While you might be able to diagnose your own physical condition, you could not operate on yourself, no matter how many books and articles you read or courses you sit through. But you can learn how to do auto repairs, fix plumbing, or make home improvements by reading books, watching television, and taking classes. You can also learn how to manage your money and buy financial products on your own. You can even use software products or websites to help with your legal needs, your taxes, and more. But this is a case where you need to go strong or don't go at all. Being partially competent to help yourself means you are mostly incompetent. You will not get away without financial help forever. You will just put it off to a point where your own shortcomings become such a problem that you can't overlook them anymore. The problem for most people is that by the time they reach that point, they have already hurt their finances and have probably done a lot more damage than could have been done by a mediocre advisor with complete training. Just because you can do these things yourself doesn't mean you should. So if you need someone to fix your financial plumbing or to put a new engine into your investment portfolio to improve its get up and go, take control of the process by finding the right person for the job and by recognizing that the right person might not be you. Key points. If the issues that are pushing you to seek out assistance can't be fixed quickly by some single action, then you are looking for solutions that can last as long as your lifetime. If that's the case, you should be looking for an advisor you can trust for the rest of your life. Every job and every task done by every financial advisor of every stripe can be done on your own without help. But go strong or go get help. Admit that you know what you are doing or that you haven't got a clue. The last thing you want is a half-hearted or half-baked effort, especially from yourself. The right time to start your search for an advisor is the minute you are certain you need help, The right time to hire an advisor is when you are certain he or she is the best person available to help you. Chapter 2. You get what you pay for, and pay for what you get. So far, I haven't heard of anybody who wants to stop living on account of the cost. Ken Hubbard. Nobody likes paying for something he believes he can do himself. Nobody likes paying for something if she can never be sure if she is getting her money's worth. Nobody likes paying for something when he can't see exactly what the provider has done to earn so much, and thus, nobody likes paying for financial advice. But unless you are sufficiently qualified and dedicated to do this yourself, you will have to pay someone to assist you in reaching your financial goals. I've heard plenty of people brag about how much money they save doing key financial chores on their own, and I am all in favor of getting things cheaply and paying no more than is necessary. But I have seldom heard those same people boast about the results. Indeed, for most consumers, the ideal financial plan, or insurance, tax, or estate plan, has three qualities. It is cheap, easy, and successful. You can get all of those things in your financial relationships, but almost never more than two of them at any one time. And make no mistake about it, costs matter. Investment returns are never guaranteed, but you're laying out money to pay for help, no matter what return you actually get, is a foregone conclusion. That being the case, costs and the ways you pay will always be a central issue in your relationship with an advisor. There's nothing inherently wrong with paying for financial help. Advisors of all stripes need to eat, too, so long as you know what you're getting, how you are paying, and can be confident that those charges are reasonable for the services you are receiving. If you were hoping I'd give you a dollar amount, forget it. It's just not that easy. Some advice is too costly at any price. Somewhere between managing money on the cheap and paying through the nose lies the ideal payment structure for the average consumer. Moreover, the range of costs can be huge depending on everything from an advisor's experience and credentials to the region where you live. There are several ways to pay for financial help. Bankers typically are not paid directly for their efforts, but have their pay built into loans and other basic services. Bank advisors, however, may work on a commission basis if they are dispensing more sophisticated advice. Tax preparers, by comparison, work almost entirely on a fee-for-service basis, getting paid either for time spent preparing a return or by the form by which each completed piece of paperwork is worth a set price. Most real estate agents work entirely on commission, while brokers, financial planners, and insurance agents can be paid in several ways, from commissions to a fee based on a percentage of the money they manage for you to a flat hourly fee. Some hybrid payment structures, such as fee offset, combine flat payments with commissions. And some fee structures are hidden, making it feel like you are getting the services of the advisor for free, when in fact you are paying for his or her services through higher ongoing investment expenses, such as the heightened costs from owning C-class shares of a mutual fund, or the insurance premiums that go largely to an advisor during the first few years of some policy contracts. One way or the other, you are paying the freight here. That being the case, you must know how and what you are being charged. Many financial services customers are afraid to ask up front because they fear the "if you have to ask, you can't afford me" attitude. To heck with that. If the advisor isn't willing to discuss his compensation with you up front, the relationship is doomed before it starts, so fire away with your questions and listen closely to the answers. Remember, Cost concerns are one of the key reasons why customers wind up disappointed by their advisor. So making sure it won't be a problem for you is critical to having a successful advisory relationship. Don't be fooled by an advisor's minimum. One of the biggest misconceptions in the advisory world is that the counselors who work with big money clients must be good. I can't tell you the number of people who have used an advisor's minimum asset requirements as a selling point, as in, he only works with clients who have $1 million, so he must be good. Ironically, these same people often feel honored that the advisor has waived the minimum for them, which actually proves that the advisor does not limit the practice only to top dollar clients. Account minimums, the smallest amount of assets a consumer needs to work with an advisor, are not so much a badge of honor or some type of accomplishment as they are a way of valuing time. There's not a great advisor alive today who started with a $1 million minimum. In fact, top advisors will regale you with stories of hustling for clients and scraping along trying to get almost anyone interested, and how they have customers who join them at the beginning of their practice who, like their practice itself, have grown from no assets to be wealthy over time. Account minimums are actually about the advisor's available time. Say a good advisor can service 250 clients and truly provide the kind of service she thinks will benefit her customers. It takes nearly as much time to service a client with $50,000 or $100,000 as someone with $1 million. But they are making 1/10 or 1/20 the asset management fees or commissions. Thus, there comes a point where it is only worth the advisor's time if his next client can be expected to deliver a certain minimum amount in fees. If he charges 1% of assets under management and has a $250,000 account minimum, he is saying that he does not want to take on clients who will fail to generate at least $2,500 in revenues for the practice. The more successful the advisor becomes, the more valuable his or her time, the more the minimum rises. High minimums are a misdirection play, getting you to take your eye off the ball, which is the advisor's ability to help you reach their financial goals. There are plenty of advisors with $1 million or $5 million account requirements simply because they have been around for a long time, not because they are great stock pickers, money managers, or investment strategists. What's more, if you are the smallest client of a big advisor, how can you expect to get the best that the counselor has to offer? It's a fair question. If you had a client whose business brings in $10,000 minimum per year, 1% of a $1 million under management, and another who brings in $2,500, who do you think would command more attention? That's why you shouldn't be impressed by an advisor's high net worth customers, nor should you feel blessed that someone is letting you into her exclusive club, even if you don't really have the assets to belong. That kind of thinking is precisely what swayed many people to let their guard down and give money to Bernie Madoff. Remember, the next great advisor is out there looking for a client like you, and she will treasure your money and not treat it like an afterthought to her thriving practice. Avoiding sins of commission. Many people go into their search for financial help convinced that the one thing they know for sure is that they do not ever want to pay commissions, where the advisor gets a cut of the action, because that encourages the broker, typically, to make moves that generate fees. As a result of that public backlash at commissions, the financial services industry has moved toward flat fees, which it pitches as a safe, conflict-free way to do business. Wrong. The most important thing to remember about paying for advice is, no matter the fee structure, there are potential conflicts of interest in virtually every type of advisory relationship. While there is no question that commissions encourage an advisor to be a pushy salesman, the issue is right out in the open, easy for you to recognize and understand. If your advisor buys you a portfolio of mutual funds and earns a commission on the purchases, but comes to you a month later saying it's time for a change, selling one fund to buy a new one, a transaction that generates a fresh commission, your guard goes right up. After all, if the fund was worth buying a month ago and you weren't timing the market, something strange or bad must have happened to justify the change so quickly. If you sense that the problem is less about the mutual funds and more that the guy has a car payment coming due, you'll quickly take steps to stop the problem. Investors worry about churning, trades made more to generate commissions than for real strategic reasons. But the attention paid to the issue and the step-ups in disclosure requirements over the years have made churning a much less significant concern. According to the latest statistics from the National Association of Securities Dealers, churning is a problem in roughly 2% of the complaints filed against advisors. By comparison, breach of fiduciary duty, where an advisor fails to put your best interests ahead of his own, is involved in roughly one of every four complaints. That problem can arise no matter how you pay an advisor. There's much more on fiduciary responsibility in Chapter 4. How advisors are paid. Let's examine the most common ways you will pay an advisor and the pluses and minuses to each method of payment. Method: fee-only advice service. How it works. Your annual fee is a flat percentage of the money that the advisor is responsible for, typically somewhere between 0.75% and 1.25%. Many advisors use a sliding scale so that the percentage drops as your assets grow, or the amount charged declines after certain breakpoints. The advisor is paid only by you. There are no commissions, either from you or from a third party, for providing you with counsel. Pluses. The advisor's interests are aligned with yours. If you get great results, so does she, because your success means a great pool of assets to charge that fee on. No sales charges. All of your money goes to work, and the fee is earned over time. Minuses. If you don't have much money to work with, you'll have a hard time finding fee-only advisors who want to take you on as a client. Most advisors want to get all of your available resources under management, which may entail selling investments you have now, rather than only handling some of your money. And critics say that a fee-only advisor can become disinterested over time because he gets paid regardless of whether you act upon his advice. Possible conflicts. The advisor's focus will be on getting assets in the door, and their advice may skew in that direction. Say you receive an inheritance and want to know if you should pay down the mortgage or invest the proceeds. The advisor's pay goes up if you invest the money and stays flat if you pay off the debt. There may also be times when the advisor makes moves not because he believes the portfolio needs to be changed, but because he knows it's frustrating to pay a fee to an advisor who is not doing something. A conflict over nothing. While paying a fee for assets under management does diminish conflicts of interest, it creates an interesting problem where an advisor may sometimes make moves in order to justify his or her ongoing worth. Say the advisor puts together a portfolio. It gives you roughly the return you expect. You go in for your annual review, and the advisor says, "Change nothing." She collects her fee, and the next year the market is not so kind to your portfolio. Nothing horrible, mind you, but you're getting nervous come annual review time when the advisor again tells you, "Don't change a thing." The third year, the advisor knows you are not particularly happy with the results. The market has been tough, and the portfolio has been in line with expectations, but you're frustrated. Fearing that you may want to pull the plug on the whole thing if you hear another "don't change a thing," the advisor advocates changes, not because they are the best long-term moves. In fact, studies show that changing a portfolio for the sake of making a change tends to do worse than going the buy-and-hold route, but because she needs to justify the fee. It won't result in more fees for the advisor, but it's hard to say the advisor has your best interests at heart. Situations like this are why there is no such thing as conflict-free financial planning. Method: commission or fee-based commission. How it works: you pay a fee, or your advisor gets a fee from a third party, on every move you make. In some cases, as with some mutual funds, you might only pay something that's labeled a sales charge when you buy or if you sell after a short holding period, but a payment to the advisor from the fund company is built into the investment structure, and you could be buying an investment that is more expensive for life in order to pay that fee. Likewise, with insurance agents, commissions frequently are buried in initial premium payments, so that it's not quite as clear as "make this investment, pay the advisor X percent off the top." Make no mistake about it, however. Whether it is a front-end load, a back-end sales charge, surrender fees, or 12b1 fees for mutual funds, it's a commission if you are paying extra and the advisor gets that money either directly from you or from the company managing the investment. Pluses: commission sales typically are available to all consumers, no matter how little money you have to work with. If what you want or need is someone to process your transactions, you can focus on paying the fee, possibly even negotiating it down, and getting the investment. Minuses: because the advisor only gets paid when you act on his advice, you may be getting a salesman more than a long-term advisor. The brokerage firms, for example, are filled with young bucks anxious to make their bones, but the rate at which these newbies wash out of the business is high. Even if the advisor sticks around, he only has an incentive to work with you when he senses a sale coming on. You may talk to an advisor today, come up with a decision on an investment or a portfolio to buy, and then may not be able to get much ongoing counsel if the seller doesn't sense that he can make another sale and capture another commission. 12b1 fee. Named for the regulation that allows it, a 12b1 fee is a sales and marketing fee paid on top of the management fee of a mutual fund. In most cases, at least some of this fee acts like a trailing commission, paying the advisor who sells the fund for his or her continuing efforts to keep your account open and in place. These fees add 0.25 to 1% to the cost of a fund and tend to be highest in cases where the fund is set up to avoid front or back-end sales charges and make it feel like the customer is not paying for the advice. Possible conflicts. The basic problem here is that the advisor's best interest is served only when selling you something or getting you to make a move. The bulk of your financial life, you are holding and building, not buying. Moreover, many commissions are buried inside of financial products like insurance policies. The advisor will talk about the benefits to you of buying a certain financial product without necessarily disclosing properly the way or the amount she gets paid. Finally, a commission salesperson may get an incentive or a heightened commission to sell products from specific companies, like the house mutual funds, or issues that simply carry a bigger front-end sales charge. Those higher payouts may unduly influence the advisor's thinking. The costs of alphabet soup for mutual funds. In mutual funds, share classes represent different ways of paying a financial advisor. For Class A shares, think all at once, because this is the traditional upfront sales load. These days, that sales charge will take anywhere from 3 to 5.75% off the top of your investment. For Class B shares, think back-end costs, because the front-end load is gone, but you'll pay a back-end fee if you sell the fund during the first few years. During the period when the surrender charge is in place, typically 4 to 6 years, you'll pay higher expenses than in an A share, with the difference basically being the compensation for your advisor. Once the back-end load phases out, it typically starts at 4 to 6% and drops by roughly 1 point per year, B shares typically convert into lower-cost A shares. With Class C shares, think costs, costs, and more costs. There is no load on the front or back end of your purchases, but the ongoing costs of holding the fund are higher forever. This is a good way to hold a fund for a short time, but it tends to be the most expensive over time. Sadly, many consumers miss that and are attracted to C shares and pushed toward them by advisors because it feels like there are no sales charges attached whatsoever. While no one likes paying upfront sales charges, Class A shares are typically cheapest for a long-term shareholder and are the only ones with breakpoints, discounts in the sales charge for investing more money. As you pass breakpoints, which can start at anywhere from $25,000 to $100,000, depending on the firm and the fund, an advisor who keeps selling you B shares is artificially inflating their payout. Some fund firms have other share classes, often for retirement plan investors or for their own payment plan with broker-dealers. Be sure you understand how it works and what it costs you. Finally, many advisors put their clients in no-load funds, meaning shares with no sales charge whatsoever. Don't be fooled into thinking those advisors do not get their cut. They may not get paid directly from the fund company, but they're paid a percentage of the assets they manage for you. Thus, if a financial planner charges 1% of assets under management and puts $10,000 of your money into Fund X, you may not be paying any direct sales charges for owning the fund, but the true cost of your fund ownership, the expenses of the fund plus any and all advisory fees, sales charges, and commissions, will be the fund's expense ratio plus the advisor's 1%. If the fund has an expense ratio equal to the average stock fund, 1.4%, and its performance stays roughly flat, your true cost of ownership in the fund will be $240, the 1.4% of $10,000 that the fund takes to cover cost, plus the $100 you paid the advisor to have that $10,000 under management. Method: flat fee, hourly rate. How it works: you pay either a flat fee for service or an hourly wage based on the amount of time the advisor works with you or works on the services she provides you. Pluses: you pay only for what you need, and you know upfront how your costs will be calculated and what they are likely to be. Minuses: there are not many financial advisors who work on an hourly basis. Those that do typically give you the basics, but let you implement the program itself. That's not good if you need help to turn an action plan into real action. The hourly fees are often jacked up, expressly because an advisor would prefer to have an ongoing relationship, so that the perceived cost benefit of paying this way disappears, and paying a fee for assets under management becomes the most efficient means of getting advice. Possible conflicts: there are plenty of ways to pile on the hours, and there are unnecessary costs that can be built into a flat fee. Overall, however, paying a flat fee or an hourly wage has the fewest potential conflicts of interest. Method: fee offset. How it works: the advisor accepts commissions and fees from third parties in addition to fees charged against your assets. When you make a move that generates a third-party commission, You get a rebate for some or all of the monies the advisor receives. Industry-wide, this arrangement is not all that common. Pluses. Ideally, you get the best of both worlds here. You pay for unbiased advice, as in a fee-only arrangement. But if the move generates monies, your asset management fee is reduced. It keeps the advisor interested in you both when she is selling you something and when she is simply giving you advice. Minuses. The fees are sometimes a bit higher than in fee-only arrangement because the advisor may have costs, order processing, sales quotas, and more, as a result of working with those commission-generating third parties. Some advisors do not give the customer a 100% rebate on the commissions they receive. Possible conflicts. If the advisor keeps some of the commissions, how can you be sure that the original advice was unbiased? You can't. And that removes much of the advantage you signed up for when you decided to go this route. Key points. For most people, the way you pay sales charges and commissions is less important than how much you pay. If you pay 1% of assets under management, and it winds up costing more than a transaction-based fee, then perhaps you need to accept that a commission setup is better suited for you. No matter how an advisor is compensated, there are always going to be potential conflicts of interest. Be aware of them, look for them, avoid them. Paying more than you have to for advice is bad, but so is paying anything for bad advice. A good advisor who helps you reach your goals will be worth what you pay him or her. A bad advisor is a bad advisor at any price and in any fee structure. Chapter 3. The 7 Big Mistakes People Make When Hiring Advisors. Learn from the mistakes of others. You can never live long enough to make them all yourself. John Luther. I have given countless talks over the last 15 years to groups of people interested in hiring financial advisors or working better with the helpers they have, and I typically poll my audience to learn about their experiences. I ask that people who are working with an advisor or who have had one they stopped using raise their hands. Then I ask them to keep them up if they hired the first financial advisor they met with, or if they hired someone recommended by family or friends. Virtually all hands stay up. Next, I ask them to keep their hands up if they did a background check on the advisor and talked to an independent reference before they agreed to work together. I have never had a single hand stay in the air. Plenty of people do everything wrong in the hiring process and still wind up happy with the outcome. But if you're listening to this audiobook, you want to avoid these common mistakes. If you do, your chances of living happily ever after, or at least until the advisor retires and you have to hire a replacement, are infinitely higher than if you skip these items and leave it up to fate to bring you someone you can work with. Big mistake 1. Interviewing just one candidate. In all of the speeches I have given before thousands of investors, I have had less than 2 handfuls of people say they had actually done 2 or more interviews before hiring a financial planner. Everyone in my audiences, except those few determined souls, was an easy mark for a rogue or incompetent. You have come to a point in your life where you know you need help. Emotionally, that makes you like a man dying of thirst, unable to tell a mirage from reality, and willing to drink sand if he can be convinced it will quench his thirst. The first advisor you meet could be a complete idiot, but almost certainly will sound great to you. That's because his spiel makes it sound like he can solve your problems, and you lack the know-how to tell if he can't, and the comparison to any other advisor to establish how you truly feel about him. You have no clue if he is selling you a bill of goods, a one-size-fits-all plan that maximizes his take and minimizes your service, or if he truly is a cut above the other helpers in your area. There are reasons why some investors lower their guard this way, not the least of which is that many financial planners, wealth advisors, and estate and tax counselors will charge a fee for the first meeting, even if it is meant to be a howdy-do. They're not giving away their time to meet you, although they will give you credit for that initial payment if you sign on as a customer. Not wanting to lose their meeting fee and feeling like the first guy seems qualified, the consumer becomes a customer in one fell swoop. You can solve that problem by arranging interviews with several advisors and arranging to meet any who charge a meeting fee last, if at all. Another reason why investors drop their guard and hire the first person they meet is that they got the advisor's name from a friend or relative whom they trust. That colors their judgment because of the way they feel about the person making the referral or the way they envision this advisor helping them live the lifestyle they see their friend or relative enjoying. Unless you know that your friend or relation put the advisor through the kind of rigorous process espoused in this audiobook, you're relying on someone who picked her helper badly, even if the outcome has been good. Moreover, if your neighbor is a doctor and you are a teacher, the financial advisor she works with may just not be right for you. Years ago, a leading financial planner in Boston told me her life was so busy with books and her radio show that she had stopped taking on new clients, and that when people inquired about her services, she gave them the names of two young, up-and-coming financial planners in the area. Alas, she had never worked with these men, had done no background checks, and had simply picked them because they were bright, energetic, and asked good questions at the Certified Financial Planners group meetings. I'm sure the people she referred to them took her word as gospel. 4 years later, one of those advisors was under indictment for fraud. Ideally, a consumer, especially someone who has never hired a financial counselor before, will interview at least three candidates before making any decision on who to work with, and at least one of those interviews will be with a candidate whose name came from an independent referral, like an industry association or a local trade group. Put a control group into your search. Think of the hiring process like a science experiment. When you did those exercises in high school or college, you typically wanted to have a control group or a control set of data, an untreated subject that becomes your test benchmark. For advisors, your control subject is an advisor who comes without the baggage of being your neighbor's advisor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.